Evening, everyone. So we're continuing with the Netivot Shalom on the Parsha Sefer Shemot, page Mem Chet. And the topic is Asher Mitzrayim Ma'avidim Utam, the Egyptians that have been enslaving them or give them work. Right? So it says in the Torah that Hashem heard the mourning and the kvechchen of the Bnei Israel. They are not screaming, but it's they're being stressed. So when somebody stressed, is like right?
Kvechchen is what you said.
Yeah, kvechchen, whatever. Asher Mitzrayim avedim otam v'skoret briti, that the Egyptians are giving them hard work to do, and I remember my covenant. So in the holy book, Degel Machane Ephraim, Vohev Israel, Amdu al Adgashat HaLashon. They were like emphasizing why it says in the pasuk, Asher Mitzrayim ma'avidim otam. Ma'avidim, it's like they're giving them work to do right now. And it doesn't say ovdim, that they gave them work. And we need to explain that according to what it was explained. And we learned many times about the special or the significant part of the exile in Egypt. The Ineba Agada, right? We says in the Haggadah, V'ilu lo tzi ha-kadosh b'ocho et avotenu mitzrayim, re'anu v'nenu v'ne b'nenu meshubadim anu leparo b'mitzrayim. If it wouldn't Hashem taking us from Egypt, out of Egypt, we and our sons and our grandchildren and all the generation will be still slaves to Paro in Egypt. And Makshim Bezen, they're having a question, what's like the advantage or the good thing that the Egyptians, that we are not in slaves to the Egyptians? Okay. We are slaves to the Babylonians, to the Greeks, to the Madaim, right? Persians. Like, why specifically to the Egyptians? Because after the exile, we were having some difficult times, and we had other exiles, right? Like today, we're still in exile, right? Galut Edom. So what's the joy and the happiness that we are not slaves to Pharaoh in Egypt? This is what we're happy about. But what about the other exiles, right? He said, indeed, the explanation that the exile to Egypt was not the rest of the exiles. Because in Egypt, we were meshu abadim, enslaved. Which means, in slavery, a complete and absolute slavery, in the body and in the mind. Right, not only in the body that we were doing the hard work and whatever they gave us to do, but also in their soul, benifsham, rucham, benishmatam. Right, we learn that there are five parts, spiritual parts for us. Right, two that we really don't understand, and the other one we don't understand too. But we learn that it's called naran. Right, it's the nefesh, ruach, and neshama. Right, like the soul, the spirit, and what else we can translate it. Because in Hebrew, there is a significant, each terminology is not a synonym, but it is something specifically for that part. Right, like the nefesh is the lower part, the neshama is the higher one, and the ruach, right? So it says that in Egypt, they were slaves not only in the body, but also in this three parts, nafsham, rucham, u'nishmatam. And they were totally dependent, right? And they were slaves. Totally dependent to the master. V'shibud zeh lo sar mev afkshish, me'amitzrim lo ra'a v'shama otam. Gam az ha'em v'shibudin l'pro v'tzayim. So that type of slavery was like 24-7, even if there was no Egyptian to supervise them. Even when nobody was looking at them, at the Jews at the time. That's like the special thing that was in the exile to Egypt, that it was called Bet Avadim, house of slaves, which was not the same thing in the other exile, right? Today, we're not really enslaved to the Goyim. When you're looking here today in the US, although we are still in diaspora, even though we have like an Israeli secular government in Israel, we are still in exile. This is not a really redemption, but none of us feel like we are slaves. Okay, fine, we owe some money to the credit card company, but we are not slaves, right? In action, they are controlling because they are stronger than us. Okay, so, you know, what can we do? We cannot really overcome them. You know, we live here, but we live very comfortably. This is the praise that we were praising Hashem, that if Hashem wouldn't take us out from Egypt, our forefather from Egypt, right, we would have been still enslaved to Pharaoh in Egypt. Again, in all our being, not only in the body, but also in our soul, spirit. Right? But now, even though we are still in exile, but we're not enslaved totally. And according to that, and the time that they explained, when we left Egypt at the time, right, we were in the 49 level of Tuma. And because we were having that Mount Sinai, the whole spiel over there, the event, right, the big party in Sinai, then our filth, the spiritual filth, stopped. And he said, it's a wonder, it's a question. Because our sages says, right, that at the time that we were in Egypt, we were doing idols, yes, but none from Israel was like doing arayot in Egypt. But what's the explanation? Because we're still enslaved to the shell of Egypt. And Egypt was considered to be ervata aretz. So they were doing idols, immorality things, right, and everything. But because we were there and we were sinking at the 49 level, even though we didn't do that in action, still we were dirty from that field. Right? And also we said in the Agada, lefichach anachnu chayavim, right? Therefore we are obligated to thank Hashem, right? Leodot, lale, leshabeach, right? To praise Him because He took us from slavery to freedom. From agony to joy, from mourning to a good day, and from darkness to a great light, and from slavery to a redemption. And there were a few aspects or context, right? There's different things in the Yitziat Mitzrayim. They were the ones that were actually working, and they went out to freedom. And also there were the Levim. Even though the Levim, right, it's known that even the Kohanim were working. But by the way, there was no Kohanim at the time. There were only Levim in Israel. But even the Levim, that they didn't work, right, still they have that type of slavery of Shetiyat Mitzrayim. And they went from agony to joy. But davar acharon shemoneh, right, mishuabud legeula, right? This is the last thing that he said, mi'agon lesimcha, from agony to happiness. And that's the last thing, because that was for everybody. The Levim that were didn't work the same work that the Bnei Israel did, they were still sad. They had the agony, right? Because everybody were enslaved to the shell of Egypt, which was the worst shell, like the negative things. And the entire nation went out from the slavery to redemption. By the way, I just learned from Rabbi Baruch Rosenblum, it's very interesting. Said about, for example, I know it's a little bit difficult maybe to understand, maybe I didn't understand it perfectly, but we just learned, right, that the exile were about the Rucham Nafsham and Nishmatam. So he said there are three, I think, numbers for the time, like 210 and then 430, 215 years, whatever the calculation. And he brings and he said that basically, they were supposed to metaken the sin of the Adam HaRishon, and that was for the neshama. So that was the number. So if you look at the numbers, each one perfectly fit in the number to ruach, neshama, and nefesh. So that was like that. That was the different number that the Torah is speaking about. Also, to bring about the Levim, and he said, okay, the Levim were not working, right? They were learning Torah. So he said that learning Torah is much more difficult than a regular work. And he bring a true story about the rabbi from Punivej when he was building the Punivej yeshiva in Israel many years ago. You know, people think that he's crazy because there were barely five people that were supposed to learn in the yeshiva. And when he built the yeshiva in Bnei Brak, he built it for 1,000 seats. And people were looking at him like, are you not like five people barely learning? So they were supposed to do the roof, the cement, the concrete roof. And at the time, you know, it was not like today, you're bringing, a crane and everything, and you just pour the cement in one shot. You had people working with buckets and the small little, you know, mixer for the cement, etc., and truck used to bring it. He said that day was a rainy day, and the trucks with the concrete, with the cement, they didn't come because it could be a problem. You know, on the way there, it will get wet, and the concrete will start to get dry on the way. So they didn't show up. So there were like 40 or 50 workers over there. And they came to the rabbi and said, look, trucks are coming, trucks are not coming. We are here to work. If we are not working, it doesn't matter. You have to pay us for this day. And the rabbi said, absolutely, I agree. However, you came here to work. So it doesn't matter for you if you work in concrete or what I want you to do. Everybody go into the building and take a Gemara and start to learn for the 8 hours that you're supposed to. He said, maybe two people stay. Everybody left. So you see from here that learning Torah is much difficult than work. They were willing to give up their day salary just right. Don't let us learn the Gemara. Right. It's a true story, right? So even the Levim, when they were working, and it's the same thing like when we used to go to war, then each Shevet were bringing like, you know, 1,000 warrior, 1,000 assistants, and 1,000 were davening for them, right? So even the Levim. And he said, and this is v'zeo inyan galut Mitzrayim. That's like the exile, right? He said that it was the most difficult exile. Ve'avdum ve'inutam, they tortured them in the body, in the soul, in the spirit, right? And they were enslaved to the shell of Egypt. Ked Rabbi Shmuel ita al pasuk ve'ta'al shav'atam el ha'elokim min avodah. Like they were screaming to Hashem, and they're screaming, and their suffering went up from the work that they did. He said that their main shavatam, the main suffering was from the avodah. What does it mean avodah? We know it's not a simple avodah that we go and punch a card, 9 to 5, whatever. Avodah is Torah, right? It means that the taste, the feeling, the sweetness of serving Hashem were taken away from them, and that was the worst. That was the worst. Like they couldn't feel the sweetness anymore. And why? Because they were enslaved to the shell of Egypt, to that negative thing, to the shell. And therefore, the taste of the avodah were taking. And they couldn't speak a thing. That's why they were so upset. V'zeh yesh lomar ha-pasuk, which you say also about the pasuk, v'gam ani shamati, and also I heard the na'akad b'nei Yisrael, asher Mitzrayim avidim otam, right? We mean that in that slavery, that they are slave to Hashem Yitbarach, the Egyptians are still giving them work to do, and they're making them slaves. And they're always with them constantly. That negative thing, the shell, that is like it's a 24/7 evil inclination that doesn't let them serve Hashem and be and understand and taste the sweetness. So said the Derech HaSipur HaYadua, it's a famous or a known story from the Rav HaKadosh Mevoditchev, Sheamar, Sheabal Davar, like the evil inclination, but come to him with a claim. He says, Imcha Haiti, I was with you, I was studying with you, I was davening with you, everything I did with you. So, you know, he's supposed to get the reward too, right? Because he was with him. So he said, it's possible that a Jew, that all his being is like actually serving Hashem. So all his Avodat Hashem and his Torah and his davening and everything will be still be infected in foreign thought, in a giyot, in lies and everything. Because the evil inclination is there with him the whole time. And this is like the influence from the Egyptian, from the shell of Egypt. And he said, this is the Na'akad B'nai Israel, that the Egyptians were enslaving them inside, in the inner, in the spiritual thing. And that was the most suffering thing that they had. But when we got closer to Har Sinai, we actually detached ourselves from the slavery in Egypt. And we became slave to Hashem. Then their spiritual filth stop because we got closer to Hashem. And this is the inyan of Shibud Nekilpat Mitzrayim. This is the thing that we were enslaved to the shell. The same way it was for the entire nation, it was also in the Galut HaPrat, for the individual one, right? Individual one. We know that A prisoner can sit in inside prison cell, but feel free. And somebody can have all the freedom of the world, but he still feel captured, right? It's only now how we look at it. So he said, there is a time when a Jew is in the hand of the evil inclination. It means that he is in galut, is in exile. And the evil inclination is not satisfied with that only, but is going to enslave him for something else. He's going to enslave his mind, his thought, his ashkafa, his Torah, his avoda, everything. Everything goes to the negative thing. Nothing will go up to Shemayim. And that's like the shell of Egypt, that the Jew will be enslaved totally, absolutely chas v'chalila, to the evil inclination. And he's not like in control, but the evil inclination is controlling him. Even though, you know, he can send him in the morning to daven every morning, that evil inclination, go to shul. It's very scary. He said, and our avoda is actually to redeem ourselves, to go out from that slavery to the evil inclination and to enslave ourselves to Hashem. You know, and that's why I think it's very important, that, again, that's my opinion, that to have a Rav, a Gadol, a real Rav, that could guide somebody, or somebody to coach and mentor, because we don't see ourselves. We don't see ourselves, right? We think that maybe we are righteous, pure person, but maybe we are not. So only when we have a chevruta, really a good friend that can actually tell us, you know, and give us some kind of a feedback. Because otherwise, we will be trapped. You know, there was a chavura that the Ari HaKadosh, they were having at the time, Rabbi Shlomo Elkabetz and the Bet Yosef, Ari HaKadosh, Rabbi Chaim Vital, all of these gedolim. And they were like a chavruta, they were a group of friends. And they made a takanot. For example, if somebody is late for davening, he needs to pay a fine. If somebody is doing something, they will tell him that he's doing it wrong. And this is how they were like mechazek each other, right? As I said, the Rabbi Saba Kadosh Milochovitz said that that when he was young, in his youth, he was like putting so many hours, he was like putting an effort every morning, in a few hours, just to say, v'chofet itzrenu, like bend our inclination to be slave to you, v'siyem, right? And he ended up, we said that today we're doing it like in a blink of an eye. But at the time, they were like really meaning it. They were putting an effort in that. Today, we're just saying things. So many times I say brachot, like I don't even remember what I said, if I said so. Right? So he said, and at the time, he was so putting so much effort to enslave himself. But okay, but today, he's doing it in a blink of an eye. And he said that this is the mitzvah of tefillin. As we said, before we put the tefillin, some say there is in the Sidurim, L'Shem Yichud, right? We're making a unity with us and Hashem. And we said that we are uniting ourselves with Hashem that commanded us to put the tefillin on the hand, which is, right, when you put the tefillin here, you actually need to feel it, like, you know, close to your chest, right, to your ribs. You say, because this is what I'm putting it on the hand, which is against the heart, to enslave my heart, which means to enslave my desires and my thought and everything, for Hashem, to Hashem, and on the head to enslave my mind and brain and my shkafa and everything to Hashem again, with all my senses and everything to be enslaved to Hashem. This is what we should have the kavana when we're putting that feeling. Right? It says, "Kol avera she'adam chote," every sin that a person do, besides the sin itself, then what happened is that he's like he's bringing himself closer to the evil inclination. So he did a sin, okay, he transgressed something, he did something, he violated. This is one story. And another story is that he has become slave to the evil inclination, right? Because it says, Chazal said that if somebody is doing something like three times, right? First time he did the sin, it was a mistake. Second time, it was a sugar, whatever. And then the third time, it became a heter for him, like it was permissible. Why? Because now the evil inclination is controlling him. Right? So said, and that's the worst thing. So said, but the worst thing, again, we're coming back, abgamim bemidat yesod. Yesod is like zera lebatala. It's when we do things that we're not supposed to do with the women or without the women. That's the thing. This is the zera lebatala. Shein b'shar averot nifgam evar, because he said here with the other sin, the part of the body is being damaged or defect when somebody is doing a sin, right? I don't know, is doesn't put feelings, so the hand only will get damaged, right? Because he did it with that hand. So only that hand will get the punishment, whatever, because the hand did something against Hashem's will or that organ. But these type of blemishes or damages, they are like for the entire body. That's why you saw this is the midah of Yosef at Tzadik. He is the one that are providing food to everyone. The argument that he had with the brothers, with his dreams and everything, with the bundle, that the bowing to him and everything, that was actually a spiritual fight. What Yosef was trying to tell them, that his midah, the Yesod, his foundation, is the most important one, because he influenced the rest of them. And the brother said, no, the malchut, right, the kingdom, this is the most thing. But we will see here, and we see from Egypt, that the midah of Yosef, he was the mashbir, he was like providing food for everyone. He was the foundation, that was the most thing. So if somebody is doing a damage in that part, chas v'chalila, like he's damaging the entire body, not only that part, right? As our sages said, right? Ein ruah, the eyes see, the heart have the desire, and the body is finishing the job, is doing it actually. So the moach, halev, ha'ivarim, so his brain, his heart, right? And all the body will become like, chas v'chalila, slaves to the evil inclination. And therefore, this is the most difficult one, as the Zohar said. He said that, and we learned it before, that the regular tshuva of a person is not good enough to fix the thing. He needs to do like a mesirut nefesh, to do something above what he can actually do. This is the exile of individual. Da'ita betoldot, Yosef, Yitzchak Yosef, I think, Yaakov Yosef, yeah. B'shem Abal, Shem Tov, HaKadosh, Shalman Da'ita, so he said, right, a Jew should request, right, as much as we need to request for redemption of the exile for the entire nation, we need to ask also about our redemption, on the individual redemption. Because what's the point if we're still in the hand of the evil inclination to have a general redemption to all? We need to free ourselves. And therefore, the bakasha, korva nafshi gela, like bring to my soul the redemption, right? As we says in the Tfilat Ribon Kol Olamim, Belel Shabbat Kodesh, before the Kiddush, right? So it's a Ashkenazi part, sheterachmeni od begaluti, like have mercy on me during the exile and wake up your love to me. So as long as the person is in galut and is enslaved to the evil inclination, he cannot really reach to love Hashem level, because the evil inclination is controlling him. And loving Hashem, cleaving to Hashem, it's a very high level. It's like beyond our achievement. But when we are in the hand of the evil inclination, we're enslaved to him. We cannot get that. Right? We cannot get that. And in our inner soul, that's like the main request or the biggest request that we have as Jews. Na'akal b'nei Yisrael, we need to really scream, you know, Hashem, save me. Because we are in the hand of the evil inclination. He says, v'zehu makor ha'tzvut, and this is the source of a sadness of a person. And many times he doesn't even know why he is sad, why he's depressed. And the source for it is because his evil inclination is in control. And that's the opposite. Sometimes a Jew is just happy, you know, I see people, they're smiling. Okay, I hope they're not on drugs, but they're smiling because they're happy. And never doesn't matter what happened to them, they're always happy because the source of their happiness is coming from Hashem. And we having this faith, and the merit of this faith, our father were redeemed from Egypt, right? Because it says Ve'aman Am, right? So they were doing many bad things at the time, but they never damaged their faith. And because of that faith, that Hashem have a direct supervision, Hashem loves us and everything, that's why that was the only merit for them to be redeemed at the time. We said that was for the nation, and that's the same for the individual one, from that strength of the faith. It's not only that we're believing that there is Hashem, he created the world and gave us the manual and everything. No, but also to have the faith that we are the chosen one, regardless of what we did or where we are, and Hashem will redeem us. Moshe was like telling Hashem, they were not going to believe me. Why? He said, it's not that they're not going to believe me that you sent me or that there is a shame. No, they're not going to believe me that they could be redeemed while they're so low in the 49 level of Tuma. This is what they didn't they're not going to believe me. But after that, it says, Ve'amenam, that eventually they did believe that Hashem can redeem us, even when we don't have the merit, even when we're in the 49 level. Because we believe that we're the chosen one and we are sons to Hashem. And also, this is what Hashem sent Moshe to tell Pharaoh at the beginning. Tell Pharaoh that Israel bini bechuri, they are my firstborn. And it doesn't matter where they are now, or what they did. I'm here to get them back, right? So he said, and for that merit of that faith that we believe that we are sons to Hashem, we will be redeemed from Egypt. And this is what we need to believe and not to forget ever and ever. Because everything will come really quickly. The same way that many people didn't believe that the Jews will return home. We were almost being exterminated, annihilated, whatever, during the Holocaust. But look at us now. Look at us now. Unbelievable. Really unbelievable. So Bezrat Hashem, you know, Mashiach will come, redemption will come really quickly. We were not going to be ready. Nobody is going to be ready. He will come. Thank you very much for listening.
Yeah. So what I want to say, I don't know if you want to turn off the recording because it's political.
So let me stop the recording.
Yeah, it's not important to have it, but
let me stop the recording.
Yeah.